Welcome to my presentation exploring the possibilities of navigating and presenting music performances with the Sixtorf Capture System. My name is Florian Grant and I'm a research associate at the Virtual Acoustics Lab at McGill University in the sound recording area. I also work for the microphone company Celia. The work presented here was undertaken with PhD candidate Jack Kelly, also from the Virtual Acoustics Lab, and Professor Wieslaw Worszczyk. In my presentation, I will first briefly talk about what is Sixtorf Audio, then how it is implemented, what the challenges are. I will then present some examples and I will end with a conclusion of what we have learned. So how can we capture immersive audio from a single point in space? Well, one possibility is, of course, higher order ambisonics microphone arrays, for short HOA. But in Sixtorf Audio, we want to ask how can we take higher order recordings towards an interactive, immersive listening experience which fully explores space. Now let's look what are the possibilities from a single point in space. We can support immersion through free head movements. But what would then be the limits from a single point in space? Well, the listener might want to move laterally. And we can try to do it like that. However, we want to move the listener and not the microphone. This is the moment where we say Sixtorf to the rescue. So what is Sixtorf Audio, or what is Sixtorf more in general? 6 degrees of freedom refers to the freedom of movement in three-dimensional space. Three position changes through translation, forward, backward, up, down, left, right, plus three orientation changes through rotation, often termed as yaw, pitch and roll. And on the right you see an image illustrating these 6 degrees of freedom. Now how can we realize that? We need more than one microphone. In fact, we need to sample a whole area with microphones, and each of these higher order ambisonic microphones has its own higher order ambisonic sphere. And now with all these spheres, we can interpolate a target ambisonic sound field of any position in 3D space. There we can then place in this 360 listening point a virtual listener. And we can move this virtual listener around along the listener path. And along this path now we can turn our head also in all the directions we want, which gives us 6 degrees of freedom. Now, how did in our recording process the 6 degree of freedom setup look like? We used the Celia Sixtorf VR-AR system, and it contains several third-order ambisonics microphones connected to a USB hub on a single computer. And the signals are all aggregated and streamed through a single USB interface. And the microphones are synced with the timecode signal, which you see here in red. To give you an idea of how many channels we record, the 9 microphones, each with 19 capsules, yields 171 channels in A format and 144 channels in B format. So it is quite a unique opportunity to be able to sync so many higher order ambisonic microphones at once within the scene, which is the condition to be able to interpolate them correctly later in the Sixtorf exploration of the space. So as I said, we recorded with 9 microphones, but with multiple USB cards, up to 50 microphones have successfully been recorded into one single computer. And in an audiovisual production made by Celia with the Poznan Philharmonic Orchestra, 30 microphones have been successfully used on stage already. And you see here an image on the right with the microphones on stage circled in yellow. Now, once you have these recordings, of course, you might ask, what can we actually do with it? And there are several ways for you to work with these recordings. One that I've shown on the very top is just to go and mix it in a digital audio workstation. Here, you just have to be mindful of all the channels that you need to be able to accommodate in one track. This is typically easy with Reaper. With Pro Tools, you can use the B format with 16 channels per microphone. The A format, however, has 19, so you might have to consider that. Then you can also work with it in MaxMSP. Cilia offers MaxMSP plugin to interpolate these many higher order ambisonics microphone sources. Here you see a version of this plugin, an early version. And you can then binauralize the resulting P format stream. But you can also use these recorded sounds in a game audio workstation. And here we can use a WWISE plugin that Cilia provides to do the interpolation in this platform. So we made a sixth of audio recordings only, and the following exploratory questions guided our first recording sessions. What is the effect of a moving listener with respect to the integrity of the scene? What is the effect of the number of sound sources with respect to the clarity of the scene? And do multiple HRA capture points yield enough material to create a well-balanced mix? I have prepared four examples of the work that we did last year. The first is a spoken word performance that we recorded in studio. The second one, the recording of a Baroque orchestra. The third is a jazz trio. And last but not least, we recorded the world music trio. So let's jump right into our examples. The first is the spoken word performance. We recorded it in the new McGill Sound Recording Studios. And we were so fortunate to have the spoken word artists Vincent Parra and Jacques Demierre, who were so kind to perform for us in what they called Le Jardin Microphonique. You see a photo of the two of them on the left and the sixth of layout on the right. And we moved through these recordings in circles of eight around the performers. So let's listen to their performance for about 1 minute. So I hope you enjoyed this performance. And what were our conclusions from this recording and the six drop trajectories that we created? Mostly that the high directionality of the voice gives a good sense of the listener position, whether we are in front or behind of the two performers. Both was very clearly audible, actually. And the other thing that helped a lot was that the tight spacing on the small surface area, which always captures both sources well, even at the edge of the microphone grid. So in the second example, we recorded the McGill Baroque Ensemble, conducted by Hank Knox, and we could record it at McGill Redpath Hall. So the genre is Baroque music, and we moved through the microphone grid in large circles, including the harpsichord in the center. Let me briefly say a few words about the ensemble. We have the two harpsichords, as you can see in the photograph, and we had the second and first violins and the flute on the right, and drums, cello, mandolin, and bass on the left. Now let's listen to this recording. Essentially, we hear the same musical theme twice with just two different, slightly different trajectories through the space. So our conclusion in this recording was that the larger distribution of the microphones makes it more difficult to represent all the sources well. Also, the big number of sources makes it sometimes difficult to maintain a consistent mental image of the scene layout. Although the parts of the recordings that I presented here weren't even the parts with most of the instruments playing at the same time. While there is an interest in highlighting one instrument section or another, all need to be sufficiently presented. And the new version of the Maximus V6TOF renderer actually allows now for adjusting the presence of distant sources in the 6TOF mix. The third example is the recording of the Aaron Parks trio, which we could do in the Salle Bourgie at the Musée des Beaux-Arts here in Montreal. The genre is chess, and you see the setup in the photo on the left. There was a grand piano, a double bass, and the drums, and you see the 6TOF layout, the top view on the right again. I'll play for you an excerpt of 1 minute and 20 seconds. The movement starts from the center of the stage and moves towards the piano. It then circles around the piano and then moves over the double bass to the drums. So, our conclusion for this recording was that moving around the piano is certainly interesting at times, but also creates surprising shifts in the perspective, as it is such a big sound source. The limited number of sources made it easy to form a consistent mental image of the stage, contrary to the Baroque orchestra. The amplified double bass monitor created, however, double sonic images between the double bass and the drum set. And again, the example that I've shown you didn't maybe show that so much, but it was very apparent in other sections of the recording. The musical genre in this case is very well suited for exploratory movements on stage. Here is the last example. It is the recording in Pollock Hall, McGill, with the Montreal Trio, Cristoforo Dimitriu, Lucio Artobello, and Omar Abou Affach. The genre is world music, and they play a composition by Papadimitriou entitled Esperanza. You see a photo of the trio on the left and the microphone layout again on the right. The movement here was actually only one short movement we did in the rendering of this recording. We were mostly focusing on the sound here and the balancing between direct sources and the room acoustics. Yet there is a small movement of the listener position, which is as we, that we move in into the trio at the beginning of the piece, which is the first excerpt, and then the second excerpt is when we listen to the middle section of the recording. So the conclusion here was that we explored only one movement. In general, we explored movement only sparingly in this recording, but the zooming in at the beginning of the piece worked very well and made sense from an aesthetic perspective. The multiple capturing positions allowed for a very convincing reproduction of direct sound from the sources, as well as the acoustic quality of Pollock Hall, and we were very pleased with that result, actually. This is just a very quick discussion, six of the trajectories pose specific challenges with regards to aesthetics and perceptual aspects. Sources with strong directivity, voices in the spoken word performance, support a sense of direction and orientation. We feel that the number of sources, a small trio or bigger ensemble, has an influence on whether a consistent mental image of the sonic layout can be formed while moving around. We suspect also that for larger ensembles, visual support might help to clarify the impression of the layout on stage. The genre of the music, as in the jazz ensemble, may suggest that the moving listener is an interesting option for the presentation of the recording. The doubling of sources of amplified acoustic instruments is a challenge for Sixtopp recordings and the creation of a consistent impression of the stage layout. So multiple higher order microphones in the scene provided, however, an interesting material for mixing and balancing direct sources with room acoustics, as we hope to have shown in the World Music Trio recording. So these are our initial explorations with Sixtopp Audio. Thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, feel free to contact me per email. Thank you very much.